It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday and this is the Wizard Magic Review. I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
And on this week's show, we are going to be doing a little tour. I'm going to do a review, and it will be a review, good and bad, mostly good, of the FISM European Championships that was held in Italy last month. And Sean is back.
Hello.
From overseas. You're about to go overseas again. We've caught him in a two-day window to join me on the show. We're going to talk about FISM Europe and also got a couple of reviews as well.
Yes.
I'm going to be showing you what I believe is the best trick I bought at FISM, genuinely bought, and absolutely fantastic. I went round the entire dealer hall at the FISM convention, and I brought back what I deemed to be the best thing at FISM Europe Dealer Hall 2024 in Italy. So, apologies first of all that we haven't had any shows for 2 or 3 weeks. I've been away, I've been on holiday, and then I went to FISM, and then I went to see Barry Manilow. But now we're back. Let's talk about the European Championships of FISM. First of all, it was held in Italy. So for me, from the UK, it was a 2-hour flight to get there. And then once I got to Turin Airport, because the European Championships was in St. Vincent next year, when they have FISM World Championships organised by the same team. That's important. You'll see why later. That one is going to be in Turin itself. But this time I had to take a transfer. I chose to take a taxi, which was a further hour by taxi, 150 quid, from the airport to St. Vincent, where the convention was held, in this amazing location. You're in the valley, you know, there's streams coming down from the mountainside and castles on the hillside lit up at night. A really magical environment. And in the middle of this was this fantastic convention center hotel, which is where most of the sort of convention part of the event, FISM, took place. The competition side of it took place in a separate area that was about 10, 15 minutes walk, which was like a huge tent. And I say it was a tent, it was a custom built sort of fiberglass building, but the production inside, like you've seen some of the clips, it was absolutely unbelievable. I registered on day one and then took a little bit of a trip around the dealers. On day one, so it's a 4-day convention. First of all, there were some fantastic lectures by Spanish magicians. And then after these sort of 2 or 3 lectures, we then went over everybody to the main sort of stage area, this like stage conference area, which was 10, 15 minutes walk away, for the first gala show. Now the gala show had in it, I believe, 4 or 5 FISM award winners. It was the first day, and already on the first day, you're getting to see the likes of Lauren Piron, you know, the, with the dancing piece of paper, Dewey's FISM Grand Prix award winning act. One of my favorite acts, Ding Yang, was also on that stage. Armando Lucera.
One of my favorite magicians, all time favorite magicians.
In the opening gala show. David Stone was on the show, and Topaz as well.
You know, day one, first show.
Day one, yeah. In the afternoon, this is 4:30 in the afternoon, you're seeing one of the best convention gala shows I have ever seen. People were on their feet, it was a standing ovation. This is 4:30 in the afternoon on day one. I'm then going back to the Billa Hotel after that show thinking, well, that was mind-blowing. And you get the opportunity during the convention to go and see Armando Lucera perform a one-man show to a very limited audience size. Now, I think he did between 20 and 30 individual shows throughout the convention. You had to book in on the app, but actually book a ticket to go and see it. When I went to see it, there was about 12 people watching Armando. And for me, Armando Lucero, it's like, it's sort of my whole FISM journey's gone full circle. Because I still remember one of my best memories, FISM in The Hague in 2003. And Armando, that was like where he first came on the scene as a magician. He wasn't at the convention, he wasn't in the program then. He just turned up and he was doing shows in The Hague. At the bottom of a staircase, and on day one there was a few people there, and then day two there's a few more. And then on the last night, literally all the top names in magic were sat around this table watching him do his coin matrix and everything, which are now modern classics of magic for anybody that have seen Armando work. But the fact that he was doing these intimate shows, you got to sit there and watch this master at work for about 45 minutes. There were 10, 12 of us in the room. It got a standing ovation. It was my highlight of the convention, seeing this one-man show. And day one's still not even over. Then you're having a break and you're going to have a bit of buffet. The one criticism of the hotel, there wasn't enough places to get food. There wasn't like coffee shops and that kind of thing. It was very difficult to get food throughout the day. And on the first day, I had to have a conversation with the hotel manager, because he said, the hotel manager, who was had a big sign saying you can pay for the buffet and it's for FISM delegates and you can pay for this buffet. So I did. And then when we go for the first buffet, we find out that it's not opening until 8 o'clock, which is the time the convention's starting, the competition on stage. So I point out to the manager of the hotel.
This is like therapy now, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
Right.
I point out to the manager of the hotel, not the convention organiser, the manager of the hotel, that he's putting this thing on for FISM delegates, but he's putting the buffet on at a time when everybody should be at the other end of the town watching the competition. You get the point. But anyway, they changed it to 6:30.
Well done, Dave.
Because me being British, I'm an expert articulator at complaints.
Yeah, you're an expert and complainer.
I'm an expert complainer. Yeah. And I got him to realise that he needed to change the time. And they did. And from then on, then on in, you could have the buffet at 6:30.
So what you're saying is you saved FISM.
I saved FISM.
You saved FISM.
Anybody that wanted to eat at FISM and eat in that buffet, I sorted it for you. Then there was a convention, the competition in the evening. Right, so at the end of day one, I'm walking back to my hotel and I'm reflecting on the first day, and I've already decided, and here's your soundbite, FISM organisation team, this is the best convention I've ever attended. It was unbelievable, and I want that to be the main takeaway. Whatever I say in the future about little niggles I've got, this is the best convention I've ever been to. If you are thinking about going to FISM in Turin in 2025, where not only will you see this level of production and this level of performers, but also a higher level of competition, because all the competitors will be coming from all over the world, without hesitation, you need to book it. Mm. You need to book this convention, because it was the best convention I have ever attended as a delegate, by far. The next day, fantastic lectures once again. The standout lecture for me, and I'm not just saying it because he was a British guy, if you were there, you saw the reaction to the lecture. Luke Jermay did a fantastic lecture on mentalism. And for anybody that does lecturing, like myself, it was a bit of a masterclass, because what I liked was he wasn't struggling to get slides on camera so you could see what he was talking about. He'd actually pre-recorded all those bits. So he went straight to the next slide and you saw a perfect image of what he was talking about in video form. So he wasn't struggling to get it on live camera as the lecture was going on. His lecture was 9 o'clock in the morning. It was on the second day, I believe. Standing ovation for a lecture. It was unbelievable. Yu did a fantastic lecture once again on social media magic. Luis de Matos did an inspirational lecture about how he dealt with the pandemic and unbelievable advice which he gave freely about how to light a $1 million mystery. If you're an illusionist that's ever thought about using a $1 million mystery...
One of my favourite things to talk about.
he has solved a major problem with it. It was in a lecture at FISM. Arguably, if you were an illusionist, that you saw that lecture and got to chat with Luis Tomatos, because these stars of magic are just wandering around the convention, you've already earned your money. Got your money back for the convention. But then in the afternoon, on the second day, the close-up competition starts. Right, here's where I've got a major moan. Okay, so somebody asked me, why are there no British guys or many British guys in the competition? Well, I think the way they're staging the close-up competition element is slightly prejudicial to the way most people perform close-up magic. And it was Mike Miller that asked me, why are there no British guys? And I said what I said to him, and he agreed with me on the day. So you've got parlour magic, obviously, which is you're going to stand there, watch me sort of parlour magic. Then you've got micro magic, but then close-up magic. The way they, FISM, choose to set up the room is you've got the table out the front, which is in the middle of a stage. Then you've got a void, so much further than the distance between us and the camera right now. But then there's a camera. Then behind that, you've got the front row. The front row entirely consists of judges. Judges that aren't really been audience members. The row behind the judges, who do you think sat behind the row behind the judges?
I've got no idea. It's going to be something ridiculous like the catering team.
No, it was empty.
Nobody.
Nobody's allowed to sit there. In fact, I thought, oh, that's empty. And I walked down there at one point with my friend Martin Sterling. We got told off. It's like, you can't sit there because you might look at what the judges are. And I'm thinking, wow, this is right. OK, so then we went back another row. So you're a close-up performer. You are in the middle of this stage platform area. You've then got a void. You've then got judges which are giving no reaction because they're judges, fair enough. Then you've got an empty row. And then you've got the first audience members. The first sort of any reflection of any audience that you want to have to feed off is 12, 15 foot away. And I said that close-up magic is not like that. If you think of how we perform in the real world as close-up magicians, things just happen. Things happen in the moment, and they're the things that make you look great, that make you a great performer, where you're interacting with people.
Yes.
Right? And for the close-up magic, fine if you're doing a stage act.
But is it an act?
Right.
If it's then, I'm going to make this go on further. Is it an act if it's based on, because I know, cause that's the type of magic that I do, so I agree with you. Physical is better for me if I can bounce off the audience. But then is that the same type of act as something like Jan Frisch doing his cup and ball?
Different styles.
That's what
so
I'm
they
saying,
all, they already have micro and parlour as different categories.
Got it.
But the ones that are close up is 90% of us guys and girls that are performing in the real world, we are working to an audience and we're interacting and things are happening in the moment and you're reacting to these people and something funny might happen. And because of the way that FISM chooses to set it up, I think it's prejudicial to the way that the majority of people perform close-up magic.
Yeah.
So, what you get now is instead of a real reflection of what close-up magic is in the real world, you get an environment which is fake, doesn't exist in real performing conditions, and you get everybody that's in the close-up competition creating an act that actually doesn't really work in the real world. They're using lighting things, maybe, you know, blacks and whites, you know what I mean. They're using, you know, their different areas of the body that would be seen in the real world. And also they're making more of a theatrical performance. Even for close-up, you know, I saw a lot of people, you know, going to sleep and dreaming and then an alarm going off and people reading storybooks and then magic happened, which is fine, but it's not the way magic is performed in the real world.
See, so this is my thoughts on that. You are 100% right, because I think I would like to enter a stage competition.
Yeah.
But doing close-up magic, which would be this, and then say, and I think I should get points because I would be staging it, the close-up magic, in a way that it could be seen from the audience.
And but you'd be in a different category.
I'd get knocked down points because I wasn't performing stage magic. They'd go, you should have entered the close-up competition.
But that's what you do. But the problem is, I think with close-up, you need, for the sake of the performers, you need to create an environment, kind of like L&L, and like we did at the IBM SAM, where you're performing, but they actually bring in a bank of spectators on either side, or if a spectator chooses this environment, they should have a half moon banquet table, which reflects how people perform in the real world in banquet conditions, and people sit around, but they can see it, and I think we, as an audience, need to not have this void, and that void be protected by having audience members on stage surrounding those close-up magicians. And I think you will get a better quality of close-up performer. Have a go at FISM. Because at the moment, it appears that all you need, you must create one of these artsy acts for it to work on camera, for it to then translate to everybody. And I'd rather see, for close-up, for the close-up element, there's three different categories, even in the close-up competition, I would rather see people there. The stage competition was brilliant. The standard was there. Yeah, there were some acts that were, you know, trying out for the first time. David Souza, that performed the red envelope effect, his routine, is one of my favourite routines in magic. He had a new routine with a linking ring. I'm sure he's going to be in the finals at FISM next year, FISM Italy Turin. Artem Shukin, everyone just calls him Artem. I think he should drop the second name and just call himself one name, like Sure, because everyone just says Artem. But Artem had a fantastic new act, FISM. Past FISM award winner. He had a new act with a suitcase. That was brilliant. That was a potential winner. But the act I wanted to win, right, was Alberto Giorgi.
Right.
Now, he did an unbelievable theatrical version of the mummy illusion, where step by step, he built a robot, and it was like a transformer, and it's very sort of steampunk. He's got sort of long hair, and it was brilliant from start to finish. There were some really strong moments of magic, but from the moment the curtains opened, you were drawn into this story of this Frankenstein robot monster being built bit by bit, and then he produced the heart, and the heart rose out of a box, which I believe was a new thing for FISM, because I've not found that on YouTube. And then he put the heart in the robot, and then the robot came to life, and he sheltered himself from the robot and got in a box, and the robot gestured, and the box was empty. And I'm in the audience, Sean, at this point, and the arm comes out of the robot, and I'm thinking, hang on. If he's in that robot, this is unbelievable. I've completely missed it. He took the top of the robot head off. He was inside, center stage at the front. He's in the robot that he's been building from the start. It was the best moment of magic in the entire convention for me.
So he won then?
No.
Oh, okay.
He came second. Go on, ask me the question. Who came second.
But even though he performed the best moment of magic.
So what's the question? So, say it again.
How could you perform?
No, so what did you say before?
Who won?
Nobody. In his category.
So he won his category.
So he said, yeah.
But he didn't come first.
By coming second. It's like, oh my
even
God.
Even though he performed the best moment of magic in the whole of the competition.
Well, I heard the audience, everyone gasped, you know, it was like, oh, unbelievable. It was brilliant. It was a theatrical thing. It was a modernised version of something I've never seen before. It was an unbelievable illusion. He came second.
And is that
and they didn't award first. And I'm like, what's going on?
Because maybe maybe they want a bit of fancy fingers.
I spoke to one of the jury members. They said it's very strict. I'll not say who it was, but it was a very senior member of FISM. And I just said, why is that? And they said, because he didn't get over 80%. And they've already got a judging criteria that you have to obviously tick all these boxes. And I know all about this. Don't think I don't know, because I'm an examiner of the magic circle. And we have to follow a criteria. There's a criteria set out. But if they don't get over 80%, they don't get a first.
They can't be first.
Even if they're the best in the stage illusion category. Now, my issue with that is I would rather see 8 to 12 minutes where I'm completely drawn in, and at the end of it, there's one brilliant effect. Like, I know he performed 4 strong bits of magic during the whole set, but I can imagine from the people that I spoke to that there are certain criteria.
If it had ruined the act by picking up a magic wand and doing a flipstick routine halfway through, he might have got first position.
Maybe there's something. Yeah. Maybe there's something with magical content.
Yeah.
That means he didn't get first. He was my winner, and Alberto, your performance, if you ever get to see this, it was unbelievable. It was a standing ovation in the competition. It was brilliant. Second place, you're not good enough for first. What an insult. Mm. This is an insult to one of the most creative performers out there today. It was brilliant. And I don't like it that the judging is done in a way that it stops somebody with that level of creativity and that much of an amazing act from not getting a first place. I think that's very sad. Mm-hmm. And I know it's not going to be changed, but I just wanted to say that was something that frustrated me. And what I said about the close-up, I spoke to Luke Jermay. Luke Jermay was in the close-up gala show, which again was another major highlight of the entire conference. Danny Day Ortiz, Armando Lucero, you know, David Stone. It was unbelievable. Luke Jermay got a standing ovation, a full standing ovation for his close-up performance. And it wasn't mentalism, it was magic. It was brilliant. And it was performed in the same environment that they did the close-up mm-hmm. competition in. Mm-hmm. I spoke to Luke after, and I'm like, mate, that was brilliant. That was like the best I've seen you. Another standing ovation. Do you know what he said?
What?
He said, really? I've got no idea. I couldn't see anything beyond the first row. So that's Luke Jermay, who's performing in the same environment as the close-up competition, telling me, and he told me I could mention it, he wasn't aware of what was going on in the room because of the lighting. So there is a serious disconnect for close-up performers and the audience, the way FISM chooses to stage close-up. And I would like to see that addressed, especially for the sake of competitors that are in the close-up competition. But I don't want to take anything away from the convention as a whole. Walter Rolfo and his team, they came on the stage at one point and they got a full standing ovation. Wow. A full standing ovation. I was on my feet. It was the best convention I've ever attended. And don't think, just because I've singled out these 2 or 3 things that I'm not happy with, I'm not happy with the convention, because it was brilliant. It was the best convention I've ever attended. I've already booked my VIP ticket for next year. I can't wait to go back. What was the best trick I bought in the dealer hall at FISM? It wasn't a huge dealer hall. I'm sure it's going to be a lot bigger at FISM 2025. There's probably about 25 dealers there. Mm-hmm. But this was the best one, best product that I bought. And it is the Algorithm by Conjuring Labs. Now, Sean, I shouldn't have this. This is an app that will help you to cheat at cards.
Okay.
It's going to help you cheat at cards. I shouldn't have this. I shouldn't really be telling people about this.
I'm interested.
It appeared on the App Store. It was there for 2 days and then it had gone. You can't download it anymore. It's illegal. You shouldn't have this. I'm going to share access with you. I could show you on my phone, but I'd rather you see on your phone. Okay. Can you scan that QR code?
I'm not going to get in trouble, am I?
No.
Not like the last thing that you sent me.
Hope not. Scan the QR code. Right. Go to that. That's the Algorithm.
Okay.
Cool. Now we can do this on your phone now. This is your phone.
Yes.
This could be your spectator's phone. And what I want you to be absolutely sure of, there's the Algorithm.
Yes,
it is now opened up. I want you to shuffle these cards. These cards have got to be shuffled. I want a thorough shuffle, a really thorough shuffle. Give them an absolute fair mix. It's not false shuffling or anything like that.
No.
This has got to be absolutely fair.
It's shuffled.
Right. Take out from anywhere, but don't look at them. This
okay.
is the incredible thing. Do not look. Slide out five cards, first of all.
One.
Don't look at them.
Two, three, four. And one all the way from over here. Five.
Right, keep those face down. Keep them face down. But what I want you to do is mix them even more.
Like this?
So give them a good mix, yeah. Really mix them.
Now mix, I've got no idea what cards I've got.
Right, so correct me if I'm wrong, if this isn't true. You have shuffled the cards.
Yes, I have.
These cards have been shuffled, right? You've then taken five cards out. Mm-hmm. You've then shuffled the cards even more.
Yes.
So let's imagine, we don't know this card.
No.
Right? We do not know this card. But imagine we're at the casino.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine you're playing blackjack.
Okay.
You've had some cards come out, and four cards come out, and you know these cards,
mm-hmm.
just like you would in blackjack.
Yeah.
Imagine how useful it would be if you could predict this card.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say that we see these cards. These cards are going to come out, right? So, first of all, let's put these cards in. So, first of all, put nine of hearts.
Ten, nine, and then hearts.
And
yeah.
this is in your phone, remember? Let's just put that in the middle, just there. So, this is nine of hearts. Right, put this one in now.
Eight of diamonds.
So eight of diamonds.
Eight, and then I press diamond, yeah.
Yeah, so, right, that's good. Then put this one in.
Three of clubs.
Yeah,
so
three of clubs.
Three and club.
Club,
yeah.
Right, and then put this one in.
So, six and diamond.
Right. Now, if you imagine we're playing blackjack, we're at the casino, right, you know that, for example, the dealer might have 17.
Yeah.
Right? And you've got nine. But you need to know if you're going to double or not.
Yeah.
You don't know whether you should double.
No.
Because you might get 19 or more. You know, you might get a good hand if this is a 10, but what if you could predict that card without seeing it? Do you see how amazing this
yes.
would be? Hit predict.
So I could, if I knew that was going to be a 10 or a jack,
exactly.
then I'd double.
So
I'd double
if you,
them.
If right. That's why this is illegal. Because if you knew somebody at the casino
yes.
and they were with you, they could put the cards into this app that was on the App Store only for a couple of days.
Yeah.
They press predict, they're going to know that card.
Right, I'm going to do it.
Do it.
Right? The
four of clubs. It's predicting from a shuffled deck, from shuffled cards, that is the four of clubs.
Let's have a look. Ta-da!
Can you see how dangerous
yeah.
this is?
It
it's
is.
Unbelievable,
so
right?
So you wouldn't double.
Now, you shuffled these cards.
Yeah.
Let's carry on. That was based on five cards.
Yeah.
So one card taken out and typing in. Let's do it with four cards, right?
Okay.
Shuffle the four cards face down. Shuffle them. You shuffle the cards to start with
yeah.
anyway. Remember that. You
yeah.
shuffle the cards. Right. Take out one card. I don't want to
yeah.
see it. You don't look
mm-hmm.
at it. Sit on it.
Okay.
Sit on that card.
I'm sitting on it.
Now remember, you're doing this yourself on your
yes,
phone.
Yes, I am.
Just three cards to put
yeah.
in this time. Sometimes it's not as accurate,
mm-hmm.
but it shows how unbelievable it is at predicting
yeah.
cards. Turn over one card.
Yeah.
So imagine this gets dealt. Right, put in
Queen of spades. So Q and spade, yeah.
Right, put in next card.
King of diamonds.
King of diamonds, put it in.
K diamond, yeah.
Right, next one.
Eight of clubs.
Eight of clubs, put it in.
Eight and clubs. Clubs, yeah.
Right, hit predict. Based on these three cards, it will now work out the card in the shuffled deck that we haven't even looked at. It reckons you're sat on the six of hearts.
Let's have a look. Ba-da!
Unbelievable, the six of hearts, and it's predicting that.
Yeah.
Somebody, look, let's create another random sort of spot. Cut just a few cards off, just a few.
Yeah.
Let's turn these over.
Yeah.
Because we're going to need some face up, but cut even deeper into the deck. Yeah. And turn these over as well.
Yeah.
Now, you've cut you've cut randomly twice.
Yeah.
Let's go to the first face down card.
Yeah.
Here, this is the first face down card determined solely by you in the shuffle deck, mm-hmm. right? We don't know this card.
No.
Take out any two of these face-up cards that you decided to turn face-up.
Yeah, like that.
These two?
Yeah.
You're going to go with that?
Yeah.
Right, okay. Put these in, one at a time. So put three of hearts in.
So three and a heart. Yeah.
And then put six of spades.
Six and a spade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just by these, just with these two cards, hit predict.
Ding, 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 ding.
King of spades. It's the King of Spades. Remember, you shuffled the deck. The King of Spades. But here's where it gets really dangerous. There are some casinos in Vegas, they play single deck blackjack.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they do.
I'm thinking about the Stratosphere. At the Stratosphere, they still play single deck blackjack. Imagine if you had this available to you.
Mm-hmm.
Just hit exit. You notice something?
Yeah, your clubs is on the face.
The same card. Because it doesn't just predict the individual cards, it predicts the entire deck of cards. Tap it or just slide it off to one side. Look, next one, King of Diamonds. Go again. Look, every single one of these cards, tapped a little bit too much. Every single card in the entire deck completely predicted by the algorithm. Whatever you do, delete your history, because I think that is illegal and you shouldn't really have that.
It's amazing.
Now, I'll be honest, that's the first time I've performed it.
It's great, it's so good.
Because
it's so, so good.
It is unbelievable, isn't it? It's available from Conjuring Labs. It's a plot that pulls everybody in. I watched people watching it at FISM. The first part, genuinely, where you've got shuffled cards, that first phase, and you take the cards out, and the app genuinely knows the card that is left behind. Mm. And it is working it out with technology. And then the rest is mixing in sort of magical techniques as well. It's not hard to do. It pretty much does everything for you. And you've got this whole act that, you know, is really engaging for a spectator. Because how many times in the real world do you get asked, can you cheat at cards? Or your spectators go, I'll take you to the casino.
There's so many romantic stories that are true about casinos, like the guys that were going in calculating the roulette with the cameras on the mobile phones.
Yes.
And there is stories and there's films. It's a really romantic idea. So you can present one of these things to your audience. And as long as you're reasonable at acting and, you know, you can get your head around the trick, then you've got something really believable that they're going to buy into.
Conjuring Labs, they have a few different products. Some are very underground.
Yeah.
I'm sure you may know about if you're a professional magician. They had the acronym app, which I have as well, which I think is fantastic.
Very good. Very, very good.
But the actual algorithm app was something I'd never seen before. I saw it at FISM. I watched it, I thought, do I want to get it? And then I watched other people watching it, and I thought, do you know what? It's an act in itself, and it's really believable. And the fact that it appears on the spectator's own phone, and it is on the spectator's phone, and it's running on their phone as long as they've got internet, I think that's unbelievable.
It's a real good lead-in as well, because you can talk about how technology might be able to help you cheat, but the real guys, they're like the elephant man, and they've got these big breasts, then you can move away from it and go into any sort of memorised deck routine. Yeah, you've got something phenomenal.
And genuinely, you end up with a deck, completely full deck, which you can use for other routines. It was the best trick I saw at FISM. I'm giving this app of the month anyway, but that was by far the best trick I saw at FISM. But Sean's back. Sean is the card trick king. So in a moment, we're going to have one last review and just see one last bit of magic from Sean Heydon before he jets off again. Finally this week, we have Project Hotter's Plucked Out. Sean, over to you. It is a card trick.
Is it a card trick? It's more of a t-shirt trick with pictures of cards.
Right.
I've got several cards on my t-shirt. Dave, what I'm going to ask you to do is just say stop anywhere you like.
Stop.
Just here?
Yeah.
On the Queen of Hearts?
Yes.
And you can have any other of these cards, but watch close. So I just pluck it off like this.
Boom.
One card comes out of the t-shirt, and that really is your Queen of Hearts, and you can see there really is a gap just there where the card is. You can touch it if you want.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's nice.
Yeah, it's a real transfer. Yeah, there we go.
It's a real transfer.
There we go. So that is plucked out. It comes with two different effects, doesn't it? It's got this version with the sort of timing force where you pluck the card out. I think that's the best
effect. I think
this
is the best version.
Yeah. Because there's another one, which is a princess card effect with an envelope. And the envelope, which looks a little bit more tricky, that goes along the front, and then the card vanishes. It's more like the princess card trick. So it's definitely gone, and then they name the card that they were thinking of, and then this card is in the envelope.
Yeah.
We had to set it up. I'm not sure we bought the right t-shirt for it.
Look, neither Dave or I know how to use an iron.
Yes, true.
Nor do we know how to go and do clothes shopping.
Yeah, because you're meant to be 100% cotton.
So we wore a random white shirt, and we both took us a little while. We learned how to use the iron. And we did our best, all right?
Yeah, we ironed it on there, and we got it on there with the greaseproof paper. Yeah. Takes about 10 minutes to set up. After you've done the transfer properly on the right sort of cotton shirt, it stays on there, but you have to hand wash it afterwards. There's about 5 or 6 different videos from Project Hotter. As with all these effects that he does, he's got a lot of t-shirt tricks now, one which is a deck production. They're all very, very original.
Yeah.
If you're happy to be wearing a t-shirt that looks like you're the magic man and you're... would you use this? You'd do it on a social media video?
Of course I'd do it on a social media video. I mean, am I going to go to a fancy black tie event and come on stage with this? Probably not.
Yeah.
Would I take it down the pub? Maybe sometimes.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's really neat. It works. It's going to be a great video.
And you get some nice little gimmicks, which just mean that the whole thing works with very minimal sort of choreography and sleight of hand. It's not that hard to do at all. How much are you going to give it?
I'm going to do it on a video, aren't I? So I've got to give it exactly 90%.
And if it ends up getting 10 million views? Your last video on Facebook this week, you're doing like nothing and getting like 300,000 views on Facebook. I don't know what's going on.
But if it gets 10 million views,
you'll increase it to 91.
I'll give it 91.
Yeah. I'm giving it exactly 79%. It's not my sort of thing. I don't like the t-shirt design, but I appreciate how much of an original effect that it is. And if you were to buy this, you're not going to be disappointed. The t-shirt does not come included. You've got to go out and get yourself a nice quality t-shirt, and then it takes about 5 minutes to set up. So that's it for this week's show. My favorite product in a very long time is the algorithm app from Conjuring Labs, as with all the reviews that we do in the future. And next time we will be back to normal with more reviews. The review pile is getting quite tall at the moment, but as with every review, we will put all the details down below. But until next time, and it's probably a long time until we see Sean Heydon again, I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
See you next time on the Wizard Magic Review.